This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, Riz Virk is back with us with a new book. He is the author of The Simulated Multiverse. He was last with us in 2019 in his book, The Simulation Hypothesis, in May of 2019. He's gone deeper down that rabbit hole, my friend. It's really, Riz is a real polymath. He's a graduate of MIT and Stanford. He's an entrepreneur, a video game pioneer, a film producer, a venture capitalist. He is a best-selling author, and these books are really eye-opening and a little terrifying in some respects, I have to admit, because of what we'll talk about, folks, over the course of the show. He's now running a PhD program at Arizona State University in Tempe. Welcome to Dreamland. I'm glad you're back.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me on again. It's good to be with you again after a few years.
Well, yeah, it is going to be fun. And or is it? Or do we already know what's happening? is somebody pushing buttons to make us move around on a board? We'll talk about all of those things over the course of our time together. I want to start out with some basics. And I think that maybe an interesting way to lead into it would be to discuss first what a simulation point is.
Sure. Well, you know, that's the idea that really got me to go down the rabbit hole in the first place of simulation theory. And so, you know, the simulation point is what I like to call the theoretical point at which we can create interactive video game simulations that are so realistic that they become indistinguishable from physical reality. And, you know, I may have mentioned this last time, but what got me into all this was I had sold my last video game company, and I was visiting another startup in Marin County, just across the bay from San Francisco, and they were building a virtual reality sports experience. And so I put on this virtual reality headset, and I was playing table tennis, so, you know, just a game of ping pong. And after a while, the game felt so realistic that for a moment, just for a moment, I forgot that I was in VR. I even forgot about this big headset that was on my face. And back then, the headsets were much bulkier than they are now. And they even had wires, so it was coming down from the ceiling. But we were in what's called room scale VR, which meant I had room to move around. And so at the end of that game, I tried to put the paddle down on the table and I tried to lean against the table. But of course, there was no table. So the controller in my hand fell to the floor and I almost fell over. And that's when I realized that our video games were getting pretty good at responsiveness and simulating the real world. How long would it take for us to get to this point where we could build something like that, which has been depicted in the movie The Matrix? And of course, we have another Matrix sequel coming out this year. So, you know, the timing is good for these types of discussions again. And so the simulation point is that point. And the stages on the road to the simulation point are the stages of technology that a civilization like ours, a technological civilization, would have to build to get to that point. And turns out, I mean, we're about halfway to the simulation point, but many of the remaining stages, you know, have already been dabbled with. So it's very likely that we could get there within a few decades or 100 years at the most. And so the way the simulation argument goes that says that if anyone has ever gotten there, meaning if another technological civilization, say anywhere in the galaxy, got to that point, they would create lots and lots of simulations, right? So there's only one, theoretically, only one base reality and lots of simulated realities, because all you need to do is crank up another server and you've got another billion beings inside that server. And so if you are a being in a reality, what are the chances that you're in this one where there's only one versus these, of which there's billions of realities with trillions of beings. And that's what led Elon Musk in 2016 to say that the chances that we are not in a simulation, that we're in base reality, are one in billions. So that's kind of a very quick overview of the simulation argument, as it's called, which was put together by a gentleman out of Oxford named Nick Bostrom, and has gotten a lot of press out there. And that's one of the reasons academics and scientists have started to take this idea more seriously than, you know, when The Matrix came out 20 years ago, it was considered just science fiction at that point. And anyway, so that's the simulation point is what kind of got me interested. As a technologist myself, as a venture capitalist, you know, I'm often involved in funding companies that are doing elements of this. And of course, today there's news about the metaverse, right? With Facebook changing its name to Meta to show that they want to build a metaverse. And what is the metaverse? It's an embodied internet where you have an avatar and you move around. So all of this is kind of coming together this year.
Well, Nick Bostrom's work suggests that we may be in a simulation. Elon Musk's rather overstated idea. I mean, but what of his ideas aren't overstated? That's actually one of the main reasons he's so successful. He is willing to dare the impossible. But we have a situation where if we are in a simulation, and it seems, it actually, tell us a little bit about why it is that physics works better just in general if we are in a simulation than if this is a conventional physical reality, as which it appears to be.
Yeah, sure. And obviously to us, it seems as if everything around us is solid. But what has happened is that the more physicists have tried to find out what reality consists of, you know, the more they look for this thing called matter, the less they can find. And that's led some physicists to conclude that there is no such thing as matter. What there is only information. And so John Wheeler, who was one of the giants of 20th century physics, and he was at Princeton just down the hall from Einstein and worked with many of the pioneers of quantum mechanics, you know, he came up with a phrase towards the end of his life, and he said that physics went through multiple phases. When he started physics, they thought everything was a particle, like a particle was a solid object, right? Like my fist or, you know, a ball. And then they thought everything was a field of probabilities, like a magnetic field or electromagnetic field. And then he came to the conclusion late in his career that the only thing that distinguished one particle from another was a series of yes-no questions. And that turns out is the same basic building block of information science. So he came up with this phrase called it from bit. So anything that's an it, like an object, like this table or the computer that you're watching this on, is made up of bits of information. And so that was one of the big clues to me that even physics is kind of coming to this conclusion that underlying everything is information. But of course, the big eye-opener for me was when I investigated the observer effect, which no doubt your listeners will have heard of. And probably, you know, the best way to talk about that is the example of Schrodinger's cat. And so if the cat is in a box with some poison and a 50% chance that the poison will be released by some quantum mechanical randomness, after an hour, is the cat alive or dead? Well, we say it's 50% chance it's alive and 50% chance it's dead. But common sense tells us that the cat is either alive or dead. We just don't know because we haven't looked in the box. But oddly enough, what quantum mechanics is telling us is that the cat is both alive and dead until that is observed or measured, right? There's there's a little bit of controversy over exactly what constitutes a measurement in that case. But the fact is that that cat is in superposition. And so both of those realities exist. Now that sounds nonsensical. So if we have a purely materialistic view of the world that says there's one single timeline and there's one physical world and that's it, then the cat can't be both alive and dead. And so quantum mechanics has come up with different interpretations to try to explain this. And one of the biggest, most important ones is what's called the Copenhagen interpretation, and that is that there's a probability wave, a probability of possible futures, one in which the cat is alive and one of which is the cat is dead. And it's not just two options. There are many options in this probability wave, and that when the observation is made, the probability wave collapses. And then we see only the one reality that we happen to be in at the time. Well, it turns out that's how we build video games. Right? The rule of thumb in building video games where you have an avatar on the screen is we don't render the entire world at once. We only render that which can be seen by your avatar inside that world. And so the golden rule within quantum mechanics seems to be render only that which is observed. And the golden rule within computer-generated video games is render only that which can be observed. And so that, you know, really led me to down this rabbit hole to say, well, if we were in a computer-oriented simulation, if the world consisted only of information, that makes a lot more sense than if we live in a physical world for all of these strange, baffling findings. And that's only one of them. There's a few others we'll talk about in terms of time and the multiverse as well. But between that and the fact that it seems like space is pixelated, like there is a minimum possible distance, which is called the Planck length, that we can't measure anything below. And other physicists think that time is also quantized. And that's pretty much how our computer simulations work, is there are pixels, and you can't really measure anything below that smallest physical distance. And then finally, we have, you know, the kicker of the speed of light being the ultimate speed in the universe, at least from a physical point of view. And that also makes no sense. Like, why would the speed of light be the ultimate speed limit? But if that is the speed at which we can send information, right? So I'm not really talking to you right now. I'm talking to my computer. My voice is being translated into bits. It's being sent over at the speed of light to your computer and rendered on your computer. And so then, you know, it all starts to fit together when you think of this idea that we live inside a computer simulated reality. And so that kind of goes beyond Bostrom's initial argument, which is more of a statistical argument related to, you know, when civilizations reach the simulation point. This is also about the fundamentals of nature and what is the world really like. And so what my last book, The Simulation Hypothesis, was all about was about the fact that space, the physical universe, is not what we think it is.
Now, Bostrom's argument is really fascinating. And by the way, if you want to actually understand where we probably are, get The Simulated Universe, because it's going to help you do just that. And Free Dreamlanders, not only should you get The Simulated Universe, you should do everything we're going to ask you to do. Now, there are a total in an average week of about 70,000 of you. Just over 1,000 of you are subscribers. As you watch these wonderful ads, think about what it would be like to really participate. For example, you could listen to, since we weren't on video at the time, Riz's last encounter with Dreamland from May of 2019 and thousands of other shows like it. We'll be right back.
UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field. And when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system. It energizes the solar system as you have things going into the sun. Even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun. It will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to UnknownCountry.com right now. Click on the subscribe tab. Get started.
We're talking to Riz Virk. His new book, The Simulated Universe, his website, zenentrepreneur.com. And Riz, I know you have another site. Do you want me to mention that one as well? Or
No, that's a good one. Zen Entrepreneur is sort of my personal author site.
So. That's what it looked like to me. Yeah, good. Yeah. Okay, well, now we're in a... If we are in a simulation, where did it start? Bostrom has the hypothesis begins with the idea that if any civilization developed the ability to simulate universes at any time, then statistically, as you said before, we're in a simulation. But what would they be like? They wouldn't be in a simulation. So what is the physics that would govern their world?
Right. Well, you know, that's a good question, right? Yeah. And kind of the big question is who's outside the simulation, right? That's what I get asked oftentimes. And is it aliens? Is it pure consciousness? Is it God? Is it us outside the simulation? And so, you know, there's actually two variations on the simulation hypothesis that I like to point out. And it's more of a continuum. And on one end of the continuum, it's what I call the NPC version or non-player character version. And so non-player characters are like the AIs that live inside our video games. So if you play a video game and there's a bartender in a guild, for example, or there's an orc, I mean, all of those are controlled simply by code. And then on the opposite extreme, we have the RPG version, the role-playing game version, where you are a player. You exist outside the simulation. You have on whatever interface that you're looking for, like in the Matrix, you know, Neo had, and Morpheus and Trinity, they all had this wire that was connecting their physical self to jack them into the Matrix. And so you have an avatar that you are playing. It's what's called a PC or a player character within the game. Now, in reality, many of our games like Fortnite or World of Warcraft or Minecraft, they're allowed to have both of these, right? You have your avatar, which is the PC, and there are these other AI-based characters that are inside. And so, you know, I think for the more spiritually minded, and this was sort of the third part of my exploration, was looking at what the ancient religions have been telling us. And it turns out they've all been telling us, right? Not just any one of them. And we can talk about that more if you like, or people can listen to some of the last interview. But the idea is that we have a consciousness or some type of soul in some of the cases outside that comes in, you download, you play a role, and then you go out. And so that's, you know, why I like to suggest, well, what if it's us, you know, outside the simulation? Like, why do we play video games? And why do we run simulations? One reason is we want to see what will happen in the simulation in terms of, you know, what will happen with the weather, you know, what will happen with the pandemic. And we run it them multiple times to try to figure out what would go on. But we also play video games to have experiences that we can't have outside of the game. I mean, at least as of today, I can't hop on a dragon and fly around and you know, shoot, you know, elf-like arrows at orcs from the sky, but I could do that within a video game, right? So the physics outside of the game could be completely different than the physics inside of the game. And that's part of what might make it interesting. Now, in Bostrom's case, he called them ancestor simulations. So that would be the same as if we were creating a simulation of, say, ancient Rome, and we wanted to see what would happen, right? They are, in a sense, our ancestors. So we're simulating older versions or older times. Now, I've talked about The Matrix. There's another great science fiction movie that came out in the same year as The Matrix in 1999 called The 13th Floor. And in that, it takes place in the 1990s. And they are a software video game company located perhaps in Santa Monica, I think. Somewhere in LA, but yeah, that tends to be a hub there for video game companies in Santa Monica. And so they created a simulation of 1940s LA. And so that was, you know, they tried to create everything to look exactly like it was. And so they could go in, and it was almost like a form of time travel, right? Because once you went in there, it's like you were back in the past. Now, the big spoiler in the movie, it's been 20 years, so I don't think I'm revealing, you know, that much.
Yeah, let's not worry about spoilers in a movie that old. If you're outraged about spoilers he's going to reveal, please send me an email, and I will not reply. Go ahead.
Right. It's 20 years old and it's based on a book that's like, you know, from the 1960s. So the big spoiler is that turns out they themselves, the 1990s, are an ancestor simulation of the future. And the real world is in like the 2040s or maybe 2020s, maybe today. And those people are also going in with their player characters into the past. And so, you know, that's another possibility. It's future versions of ourselves. And so what happens within this whole discussion of simulation, we get into a lot of, you know, almost philosophical questions, but also questions of time, and what is reality and what, you know, what is time? And those are some of the questions that I delve into, you know, in the new book as well.
And the question of what is time, we're going to get to that in a few minutes. But I want to do two things. First, I want to circle back to earlier religions. But before we do that, I want to ask you about games you think would be cool for people to play who are just interested in the simulation hypothesis as a possibility. Are there games, you mentioned one just briefly, that takes you back into the 1940s, but are there games that really you would say are great for someone exploring this idea?
Well, that's a good question. And you know, games change all the time. And I used to spend a lot of time in games. But since I started creating games, I tend to not spend as much time playing them myself. But, you know, there's a game from a few years ago called No Man's Sky, which I referenced, you know, in my books. And that game has 18 quintillion planets, which seems like, you know, an almost infinite number of planets. But what's interesting is that they make sure each of those planets is different. And the way they do that is they use something called a procedural generation. So they create different plants and different animals and different landscapes, but they don't have to create each one individually. I mean, that would take forever. Imagine right. Having to have a team, 18 quintillion teams.
18 quintillion is a fairly big number.
Yeah, and if anyone wants to know why that number specifically, because it's 2 to the 64, right? And so when you have 64 bits, that is right. The biggest number you can get. And we'll talk about that in relation to quantum computing at some point as well. But what's interesting about that game, and you know, there's also, you know, simpler worlds like Second Life, which I used to spend a lot of time in. And that one is interesting from the perspective, not so much the physical procedural generation, which isn't nearly as realistic as, say, in No Man's Sky or in Cyberpunk 2077, which is a game that Keanu Reeves' voice was used for. And, you know, he helped introduce. And so there's bugs in that game, but that game is pretty well known. And they're getting better all the time. But the graphics are amazing in that game. With Second Life, though, you really start to get a sense of the social dynamics, right? Where there are people who still log into this. And, you know, it was about a decade ago when it was super popular. But, you know, people have jobs. They have to log in at, you know, 10 p.m. every night so they can be the bartender in the bar. And so there's this whole idea of living a virtual life. And of course, there are many newer games as well that are starting to come out within virtual reality. So if you have a VR headset, you can definitely explore many of those in the Oculus. But, you know, even VR chat and some of these are interesting. What you'll notice is there are some games that try to get the fidelity right. But it's not just about visually looking right. It's also about the responsiveness and the interface. Like when I was playing that ping pong game, that was almost 5 years ago now, 2016. So the graphics were not nearly as good as they are today. But the physics felt like I was actually hitting a ball because as soon as my, you know, hand got to the right point, the ball would move the other way. And so eventually there will be haptics, where they can use little electrical signals to stimulate the hand to feel these types of things. There's also brain-computer interface work being done where they can read the signals from a brain. And each of these is one of the stages on the road to the simulation point. But for today, those are, you know, some of the games that people can try. And of course, you know, there's very popular ones like Fortnite and, you know, which had a Travis Scott concert, who's a well-known rapper that had 12 million people attending the concert. So I would suggest, you know, attending a concert in virtual reality in the metaverse is much safer than attending a physical concert these days, you know.
Well, if we're going in the direction of creating ever more realistic simulations? Are we eventually going to be a simulation that can create simulations? And would that then be what the original simulators are? In other words, nobody's real. So where are we? And that gets me to go in another direction altogether. There's a book by Max Tegmark, a mathematician. You might be familiar with it. Called Our Mathematical Universe, which makes the point that math had to precede reality. Whatever caused reality to emerge, the mathematical principles that caused it to emerge the way it did were already there. So who's behind the behind? And my question then goes back to the old religions and the fascinating ideas you have there, because maybe a long time ago, somebody knew more than we do now about that.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, starting with this idea of stacked simulations, right?
Right.
Was the first part of your point. And, you know, that's a question that comes up. And it would be the same as us creating a simulation, which then creates another simulation. And, you know, one of the questions becomes, you know, where does the computing power get used, right, within these environments? So, for example, you know, there's a pretty popular gaming platform called Roblox. And within Roblox, a lot of kids play it, a lot of teenagers and even younger. And they create their own games, you know, within Roblox. And so you've got kind of this multiple levels. You know, earlier I mentioned the 13th floor. And in the 13th floor, it was kind of a set of stacked simulations. And when at the end, when the people from the future came to the present, quote unquote, which was in the 90s, you know, they said, we made thousands of simulations and you're the only ones who created your own simulation underneath. And, but we have to shut it down because it's going to use too much computing power. Right. And so you get into this interesting aspect of, you know, the amount of computational power in the universe. And so, you know, this takes us back to Max Tegmark and the idea that mathematics underlies everything that we do, which is very true in a simulated universe because we're using our mathematics to design and create what are called 3D models, for example. And those models are then rendered. So it's almost as if there's an underlying design, but it shows that there is a informational aspect. Now, there's a well-known physicist turned computer scientist named Stephen Wolfram, and he came up with this idea of computational irreducibility. And he said that in physics, the way it's been viewed till now, we use equations to try to figure out what's going to happen. But more important than equations in the future might be computation. And what he defined this phrase computationally irreducible, which means that in order to find out what will happen, the only way to do that is to run the simulation for those number of steps or to compute. So if you want to find out what's going to happen in the year 2 million, you have to go to the year, you know, 1,999,000, November, December, and then you'll find out what's going to happen because of a concept that's become popularly known as chaos theory, which is that even if you change a few small variables in the present or the past, they will have these big different outcomes, like very large differences, kind of like the old idea of the butterfly flaps its wings in you know, Hong Kong and it affects the stock market in New York, right, through a whole series of what seem like little things, but they add up to very big things. And so, you know, mathematics is important, but we're starting to learn. I like to say that information science is eating all the other sciences, right? Like even as we get into biology, we look at DNA, which consists of genes, which are really just compact pieces of information, you know, that are being strung together. And so every single science is starting to find that there is an information science and number. And even within physics, you know, they used to talk about the conservation of energy. Now they also talk about the conservation of information. And the fact that we're getting, just like mathematics is more theoretical, information science is even more theoretical in a sense. So we're getting back to the fundamentals of you know, the universe. And of course, that brings us to what you're talking about, which is the ancient religions. So, you know, is it possible that the ancient religions had known that we are inside some kind of an elusive reality? And as I mentioned, pretty much all of them say that we are. And if you go back to the Vedas, which were written some, 5,000 years ago.
We've come up on a break. So we're going to go back to the Vedas, folks. But for you free dreamlanders, we're going to do it after these messages. Subscribers, you don't have to listen to the messages, which will be very pleasant because this is a hell of a good conversation. We'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing. He was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today.
We're talking to Riz Virk, his new book, The Simulated Multiverse. If you want your mind blown, it's simple. Get the book. Read it. As I did. And do I look like my mind is blown? I should, because it is. His website is zenentrepreneur.com. And if you are a subscriber, you can listen to his previous show from 2019 about the simulation hypothesis, which is equally interesting, but in somewhat of a different way. Now, before we paused for the free dreamlanders, we were getting ready to talk about ancient religions, and you'd brought up the Vedas. So let's go ahead with that now.
Yeah, absolutely. So if you look at, these ideas which emerged in ancient India, basically they use the terminology of Maya, which means illusion. But if you look at it closely, it means carefully crafted illusion, right? In the way that a stage magician, might create an illusion that looks real to you, but isn't. And in the Vedas, they also talk about the Lila, L-I-L-A, which means the play of the gods. But it's also interpreted as a stage play, right? Which again ties to this idea of playfulness. And human playing in games is one of the oldest forms of human activity out there, and video games being just the latest interpretation of that. But we have to remember that these are all metaphors that could be understood by the people of the time. Another metaphor that's used quite readily is that of the dream. It's used within Hinduism, but also within Buddhism. And after the Buddha achieved enlightenment, when he saw the nature of reality, which he described as a series of causes and effects, right? Almost like a logical set of steps or computation, if you will. Someone asked him, what are you? And he said, I am Buddha, which is the root word from Sanskrit that led to Buddha, which means basically awake, right? So if you're awake, that means the rest of us might be asleep. And so, you know, dreaming has played a pretty important role within different sects of Buddhism, particularly in the Tibetan traditions, where they've preserved dream yoga. And so dream yoga is where we learn to do lucid dreaming, which I know, you know, you have done on occasion and which I have done on occasion, where you wake up inside the dream. Now, lucid dreaming in the modern sense, we deprive it a little bit of the spiritual context of dream yoga. But the purpose of dream yoga wasn't just to wake up and do interesting things in our dreams, but to understand that what we thought was real is not real. And as the Vedas and I think the Upanishads say, take me from the unreal to the real, right? That is the process that goes there. And so when I looked at, you know, each of these metaphors, I realized that, you know, we would use an up-to-date metaphor today. So in the 20th century, Yogananda, who wrote Autobiography of a Yogi, and about whom I'm actually writing a book at the moment, you know, he was one of the, what's been called the first modern guru coming from India to the US, and he used an up-to-date, quote, modern metaphor for 1920, which is when he came over, which is, he said, it's like a motion picture, right? When you're watching a movie of World War I, it looks like there's great suffering, and there is inside that movie, but you have to remember that it's all a carefully crafted illusion. So I like to think that if the Buddha, or if Yogananda, or even the rishis who wrote the Vedas long ago were alive today, they would say that it's like a stage play, but it's interactive, and each of us plays roles. Like Shakespeare said, all of us are the world's a stage, and the men and women are merely players, but it's interactive, it's like a movie, which means what? It's like an interactive video game, right? That's the best metaphor thus far about the nature of reality. Now, it turns out the Western religions, the Judeo-Christian traditions, also say that the world is, you know, not the real world. And they talk about this idea that everything we do is being recorded in the Book of Life. Or in the Islamic traditions, they're much more specific. They talk about the scroll of deeds, which is a list of every single deed that you've ever done that gets written down in a book by an angel. And so you have two angels per person. Now, today, we realize that's probably a metaphor, right? Why would you need like 14 billion angels to write down in physical words? Today, we would just record what is happening in a process that we call daemons, which is from the old Greek word. A daemon is a process on your computer that just runs and does the thing it's supposed to do. And we do this all the time. Kids, you know, stream their video games to Twitch. And so you can go back and you can watch any point in the game and you can find out exactly what happened. So I think, you know, today the video game provides the best metaphor that's really been available. But if we look at what these religions have been saying, even going back to the idea of reincarnation, you download into a body, you play that role until the end of the body, and then you upload, and what's preserved? There's some information which is called karma in the Eastern traditions. And that information is stored where? We don't know. Somewhere in the cloud is what we would say in Silicon Valley, right? It's stored in a server. And in fact, between Buddhism and Hinduism, there's this question of, is there really an indestructible soul, or is it just a bag of karma, which means a bunch of information that gets stored about the previous lives that you've lived. So it's just interesting to me that it seems like all the major religions have been telling us all along that the physical world is not the real world. And that's really, you know, gave me more confidence, not just in the simulation hypothesis, but in its ability to bridge the gap between science and religion. And we're seeing this where some scientists are becoming more open-minded and more open to consciousness and some of the areas that religion explores, but there's a majority of scientists who seem to be moving the other way, right? And so, you know, I think this is one of the few concepts you can discuss with physicists, computer scientists, technologists, philosophers, people in religion, and members of all religions.
Well, I mean, I did a long study of the Jesus teaching, and it became clear that I wrote a book called Jesus, A New Vision about this. And a big part of that new vision is the realization that the kingdom of heaven, which is within us, he says, is essentially a discovery that this world is not real as we see it. And once you reach that point, you've spread your wings and you've risen above the world. And the whole journey of the Sphinx, which is courage, strength, and the courage and strength, the strength of the bull and the courage of the lion, that is to say, the physical part and the emotional part being balanced by the brain, by the mind, the head of the man, then it spreads its wings and rises above the world again. So the question now is, can we get out of the simulation in some way and still remain real?
Yeah, and that's a great question. And I think part of that depends on if you take the NPC version or the RPG version. And so if we are, in fact, playing characters in the simulation, then we should absolutely be able to get out of the simulation, right? In the same way that when we're dreaming and we're having a lucid dream, we realize that we forgot there was another part of us that we just remembered, right? There's a phrase, a Greek phrase called anamnesis, which means remembrance or loss of forgetfulness, right? And in some of the Greek traditions, we cross the river of forgetfulness when we come into this life, and we forget that there's something else beyond. And so, you know, that process within lucid dreams is meant to reawaken the memory of the you that's sleeping in the bed. And so similarly, I think we can do the same thing. We can wake up and remember that this is a game, and not just that, but that this is a single run of the game. And you know, that leads me to the work of Philip K. Dick, who I talk a lot about. You know,
yeah, let's talk about that. We shared the same agent, me and Philip Dick.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Not at the same time, unfortunately. I didn't know him. I wish I had. But it was very odd that we would kind of, because I have a lot of Philip Dick in my own work too. But go ahead. But he was the master. So let's talk about him.
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, when I was writing the simulation hypothesis, I interviewed his wife, Tessa. And, you know, there was a famous speech that Philip K. Dick gave in Metz, France, in the sci-fi convention there in 1977. And there was a famous line from that gets used in simulation theory. And Philip K. Dick was said to be an inspiration to the Wachowskis, who created The Matrix as well. And as you know, his work was very much concerned with two big questions, one of which is, what is real and what isn't real? And so that line was, we are living in a computer-programmed reality, and the only clue we have is when some variable is changed, some alteration in our reality occurs. And so most people focus on the first part of that, which is that we are living in a computer-programmed reality. He was one of the first to say it. And you can watch the original video, and you can see the audience in 1977 saying, okay, he's looking like this guy must be crazy. What is he talking about? Because you can think of the state of computers in 1977. I mean, we had Atari and we had Pong and we had a few video games and that was it. But after I wrote the first book, and this is part of what led me to write the second book, I went back and listened to and read his entire speech. And it turns out the second part of that statement was perhaps the more important one in a way, because it gives us a clue as to why we would be in a computer program reality. And the second part of that statement says you can change a variable and you can rerun the simulation. And he said we would have the sense that we were saying the same words, we were reliving the same event, we were hearing the same words, we'd have a feeling of deja vu. And that this feeling is an important clue, he used. And what's today what's called a glitch in the matrix. And Whitley, I think the first time I was on your show was in 2018 or 17 with my book Treasure Hunt, which was about glitches in the matrix and clues. And so, you know, he came to believe that we that these folks, whoever they were outside the simulation, would change a variable and it would lead to a different timeline. And so many of your listeners may have heard of The Man in the High Castle, for example, which is about an alternate timeline of where Germany and Japan won the war. And so Philip K. Dick came to believe that was a real timeline that had happened. And for whatever reason, the outcome was not optimal. And so whoever was running it went and changed the variable. And then we ended up on this timeline where the Allies won World War II. Better for us, obviously, in this timeline.
Well, Philip Dick had his life is so interesting to me because, among other things, we share an obsessive interest in ancient Rome and the feeling that we're living in two realities, one of which is Rome, and that hasn't ended. It's still there. And, you know, a few weeks ago, I happened upon a show on Netflix, I believe, called Barbarians. And I don't watch a lot of TV because I read a lot. But I was attracted to this show because it was about ancient Rome. And, you know, most of the shows about ancient Rome are horrible. They don't know a thing about what they're right. What they are. And this one was fairly good, actually, in some respects. In other respects, it was idiotic. But what happened, though, was that the Romans in it speak Latin as it was spoken. And when I heard that, a shock went through my body and an immense wave of nostalgia. And for a little while, I could understand the Latin perfectly. But when I realized I was understanding it, I was so fascinated by that I lost the ability to understand it, and I couldn't understand it anymore. It was like the unexpected presence of that language plunged me back for a moment into another world, or slid me into another reality. And what are these things? Time slips and things like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And so that was the clue that unlocked for you, you know, perhaps this other reality. Now, Philip Dick came to believe that we, you know, a part of him was still in ancient Rome.
Right? Exactly.
And he claimed that, you know, what happened was when he wrote The Man in the High Castle, it was based on fragmentary residual memories of this other timeline. But later he had an experience which caused his anamnesis. That's actually where I first learned the word, which caused him to remember that entire timeline, an alternate present. And so, you know, we talked about lucid dreaming earlier. One of the techniques to recognize you're in a lucid dream is if something in the dream environment, it reminds you of something, or it looks odd or off, like something here isn't quite right, or has a sense of familiarity towards you, right? And so that seems like in this case, it had really, it stimulated your consciousness. And so you started to remember either another reality or perhaps a reality outside of this particular simulation that took place in ancient Rome. And I think we all have these types of experiences, you know, from time to time.
Now, continuing on with the Philip Dick universe, or the universe is, I should say, it's a plural. Could there be an intrusion from outside of our simulation, like Valis? Can you tell us a little bit about what Valis was and how it affected him?
Yeah, so, you know, he has a few novels that he wrote later in his career because he kind of became obsessed with this idea that there was a, you know, a very large intelligence system, I think is what Valis stood for. I think there's an A in there. I don't remember the exact acronym. But he also wrote another book called Radio Free Albemuth, where he kind of made it smaller and a little more digestible to a lot of folks. But, you know, in that, you know, he had several experiences, including one where, you know, he found out that his son had some kind of a particular ailment, and he had to take him to the doctor right away, even though there was no other indication. And it turns out it saved his son's life because they did find this particular thing he was looking for. But he sort of came to believe that this active, that's what it was. It was an active living intelligence system was sending messages. And, you know, from a satellite, he came to believe is where that information was coming from. But depending on which of his books you read, you get a slightly different version of this. And when I spoke to Tessa, you know, she mentioned that he at one time saw what appeared to be a blob of light in the living room. And she said she saw it a little bit too, but he saw much more clearly that there were actual beings in there telling him that they were the ones, or some of the ones, who were able to change these variables that he talked about. And for example, they gave him the example of the assassination of JFK, which they said they changed the variable, they reran the simulation, and it prevented him from being assassinated in Dallas, but he got assassinated in Orlando, or he was assassinated somewhere else. And so, or it led to an outcome that was not an optimal outcome, like a nuclear war. So they rewound that, those particular runs of the simulation. But it's this idea that we can communicate, you know, with whatever intelligence it is that is running the simulation. But, you know, he also talked about the fact that we that he remembered this alternate present, and that there were another group, if we could find another group of people that remembered some other alternate present, then that would be more evidence that what was going on was not unique to him. And then what led me to write this book was partly this phenomenon called the Mandela effect, which is another group of people who remember an alternate timeline.
Yeah, let's talk about time slips and alternate timelines now. But first, Free Dreamlanders, you've been waiting for this. We're a little late, so we're going to add a few commercials in here that we wouldn't have otherwise put in, just so you can enjoy them more. We'll be right back.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia. Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. You were, what happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started.
We're talking to Riz Virk. His new book, The Simulated Universe, dynamite journey, as you can tell, into what might just be the real world. And it's looking more and more like that's what this is. His website is zenentrepreneur.com. That's zenentrepreneur.com. Riz, if this is a simulation, then why? Why? Why are we here?
Right. Well, that's, you know, the big question. And, you know, I think it's important. It's an important question because it reveals the nature of this grand play or video game, which is, what are the rules of the game? What are the achievements and the quests?
Right.
Right. I tend to take
it, just yeah. I didn't really complete my thought. I'm sorry. Why are we here? And who was in that ball of light in his living room? And how would they alter? It's a complicated question. Let's just start with that, and then we'll go back to the ball of light. I'm sorry.
Sure. Either way. So we'll start with the why are we here?
Yeah. And then we'll go back to who's in the ball of light.
Sure. So in terms of, you know, why we're here, I tend to take the point of view that we're here to learn lessons. And in the same way that, as I mentioned earlier, we might run a simulation in order to see what might happen, which is this idea of computational irreducibility. The only way to know what might happen is to actually run the simulation and to see what choices people make, but then also to go back and change those choices and to see if that would lead to a very different outcome. What in the end is the goal? In my personal opinion, it's to gain experience and to learn lessons. And if we, you know, tap back, this is a metaphysical question, and we're almost in the realm of religion, right? Why are we here? And if you go back to the Eastern traditions, they say that it's almost as if we have a series of quests and achievements. So video games today, you know, you don't just play the game, even what seems like a free form game, you choose your character. And the character has certain strengths. Like in the old days, we used to have Dungeons and Dragons character sheets. And we would say, you know, my character is really smart, or the strength is high, and he's a warrior or a barbarian or a magician. And you choose different attributes. And I believe we all have different attributes and different things that we are interested in, because they're part of our character that we have chosen to play this time around. And so the way video games work today is you have quests and achievements. And at some level, you have subscribed to those achievements, right? You don't just get thrown into a quest. You say, here's a list of possible quests that I have not yet done, but that I need to do. And I choose one of those. And then that becomes the quest that you take on inside the video game. So, you know, for me, this question ties to another one, which is, why is there so much suffering in the world? People often ask, right?
And yeah, that's getting back a good question, because the world is based on suffering. Look at nature. Everything suffers. Everything.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. But, you know, when you think about Yogananda's analogy of watching a movie of World War I, that which makes the story interesting are the challenges that we face and how we deal with them. And so if there were no challenges, one, it wouldn't be a very interesting movie or a very interesting game. Two, we wouldn't learn anything. And you know, three, no one would watch the movie. And in The Matrix, in the sequels to The Matrix, obviously there's a new sequel coming out this year, but in the original sequels, they said the first version of The Matrix was not the dull, challenging place that we saw in the first movie. It was kind of an idyllic environment, but the human brain wasn't absorbed into that, they said, right? So we didn't believe it was real. So it's almost, if you think of the carefully crafted illusion, right? The illusionist always needs to turn your attention away from what is real. And so the suffering, in a way, is part of that illusion. Otherwise, you know, we wouldn't be able to fully absorb ourselves in this world, and we would start to remember that it was all an illusion. And so, you know, perhaps the game is more fun if you can really play the game and not remember that it's just a game until later on.
But, you know, I'm getting into a question overload situation. I've got so many questions, I can hardly think straight. But I'm going to go back to the ball of light. I'm going to force myself to do that. And then we're going to go, and I don't want to drop this, because I usually, my questions are very orderly, but this is sort of blowing my circuits here. I want to get in after that to the idea of what if we create video games that have artificially intelligent players, figures in them? In other words, if the characters in the video games become not just artificially intelligent at a low level, but they become self-aware. We'll get into that in a few minutes. But first, let's go back to that ball of light and who was in it. Was he looking at the controllers of this world, or was he looking at us in another way?
Well, so that's a good question. I mean, Tessa, his wife, told me that he saw beings that kind of looked a little bit like what we would call the Grays, right?
Yeah, of course it was the Grays.
So now we're into, you know, the UFO question and the territory. But they were communicating with him sort of psychically. And Tessa, he looked like he was in a trance, right? That he was, but she definitely saw something there. She said it was kind of like, not just a blob of light, but kind of like when something shimmers and you realize there's something there that you can't quite see, but you know there's something there, like kind of in science fiction where they put on like a invisibility field around them. And that's what it reminded her of. But it sounded to me like that though they were part of the controllers of the simulation, meaning that they were part of the group that created the simulation, and they had the ability to change different variables along the way. Now, in his writings and in his speech, he talks about this idea of the programmer and his dark counterpart. Now we get into kind of the religious ideas. But he said it's as if they were playing a chess game and they're allowed to go back and change pieces, not just in the present, but in the past. And, you know, this will lead to a further discussion of the Mandela effect and this idea that in certain religious traditions, there are beings that live outside of time, like the jinn in the Islamic worlds. And we can come back to that as well.
I think that there are beings living outside of time. And I think that one of the reasons we experience so much fear when we're near these grays is that that's where they live. They live outside of time looking in, and it's terrifying to us because it is there is a sense, a desperate sense of losing control when you're near someone like that. Free Dreamlander, speaking of losing control, you've lost control of the show. It's time for us to go. We're going to go on down the road with our subscribers, down a dark and fascinating path, because at the end of that path is a question of what if we create conscious beings in a simulated world? We're not that far from doing this. It's not impossible at all. We can literally see that skill on the horizon. So, are we going to rediscover ourselves in a game platform, or are we going to discover that we have always been what my wife said? The first thing she said after she died and began to communicate with me, Whitley, she said, "It's a game." Thank you very much for being with us, Free Dreamlanders. Subscribers, we're going to keep on keeping on. We're talking to Riz Virk, his book, The Simulated Universe, his website, zenentrepreneur.com. Riz.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.